constitutional government on the basis of this guy's novel. But anyhow, the upshot was all of a sudden they changed from being terribly excited on having me do this show to calling back and saying, NBC or whoever it was, I don't recall right today, whoever it was, they weren't going to do it anymore. So that was the end of that. But to get back also to the, I don't know where they are now. You know, we have some natural things taking place in the weather. There are weather changes going on that might be put into strictly the category of natural weather changes.
Well, Mars has its ice caps melting. The entire solar system has been going through changes, and paying Al Gore money won't stop the ice caps melting on Mars.
Correct. So, but they do exist. But what they've ended up being able to do, so that people have a handle on this, just in general with weather control, they moved from what used to be the archaic manner by which trying to change the weather with seeding with a variety of chemicals and things of that, to what is now electronic means to alter and control the weather. And basically by using frequencies, plasma beams, and superheating the ionosphere in a specific targeted place, they can actually superheat the water, let's say the ocean, over a given square miles, or they can superheat at the same time the ionosphere, causing that weather change that normally might happen by nature with the hot and the cold weather hitting each other.
Exactly. They go, that's what Livingston said, you know, the father of weather weapons. He said they go and find already the tipping point area, and that's where they can get full control. They can create hurricanes. Stanford Research Institute had certified it by 67. They can kill them, weaken them, make them stronger, and steer them.
Yes, and that's the big point. That's exactly what he's saying is exactly what I was about to say, and that's it. Now, there's three parts to this thing now, too, in terms of who is doing it. We are doing it. We are doing it profusely with under the HAARP program is only one part of it. The acres and acres of the antennas, towers, and all that up in Alaska. There's another location similar to that on around the equator area, but we have moved into using aircraft and satellites. All right, so you can do a triangulation assassination would do with two or three people shooting at one person. You have the same kind of a triangulation application with plasma beams from two or three different places, two satellites and maybe one ground base, and hit a given area very specifically, so many miles up and so many miles east and west, superheat the atmosphere, and this is where also these some of the contrails come in. Some of the contrails they discovered, again, was I think an accidental thing a few years ago, but that certain types of material, et cetera, could hold temperature if they were floating in the air. They found out they became conductive to hold an increased temperature. So if you put out a contrail in a given area, hit it with these totally invisible, like a microwave beam.
Well, that's what the other scientists have told me, is that it's not just that they're adding stuff to the jet fuel that aerosolizes in some cases, or they have special jet planes, you know, that go out and do heavy chemtrailing, but that the beams they're firing into it is already resonating with natural nuclei forming out of the ice crystals, and they're using the airwaves as the exhaust paths and the ice crystals as systems to beam data down over the horizon radar, heating the atmosphere. It's everything.
That's the problem. It does. It gets into a lot of different areas. And by the way, in 1995, when I had just was receiving the, it was late 94 when I first got the United Nations Treaty. Very late, I mean, it's like the end of the year. At the beginning of 95, I was able to get, again, utilizing a friend out of Washington, et cetera, I contacted the right person, and they sent me what amounted to being probably 1,000 documents. It was 2 cardboard cartons, and they came basically. This came out of the United States Air Force, and it was their entire weather as a force multiplier. It was the entire concept of not only how they were doing it or planned to do it and how it was being put together, but global weather networking. The application of military systems for weather modification operations.
And by the way, you said this 15, 16 years ago. It's all been declassified now. The exact names that you've used, what they've talked about. And again, Bill Gates says that he's going to have this global weather bureau that controls your weather. And see, if you don't pay him, well, then some bad things are going to happen.
It's amazing. Now, and also to say that I said something just briefly or a couple of minutes ago, there's a three-sided deal to this now. All right, so we have what I call the covert government, the secret government that's trying to control and mess up America's future here and putting it all into their pockets, so to speak. One world government control.
They're threatened by freedom because it will stop their monopoly. They're bad guys.
Right. And what they've also done now, however, way back a long time ago, the Russians were involved with us directly at Lawrence Livermore Laboratories. The Russians were even given an award for their cooperation. But they were here in Lawrence Livermore Laboratories working with our scientists on some of the earlier concepts on this many years ago. So what happened was the Russians back in the 90s, around the period of time that I was getting a hold of all of this, the Russians set up a company called ELATE, E-L-A-T-E. And this was the Russian weather control and modification.
And they don't hide it. That's why they cleared things out for the Red Square events. I mean, they advertise they control the weather.
Right. They actually said that back in the 90s that for a couple of $100 American, a farmer could get guaranteed rain over his area and all that. Now, I don't know if they ever got to be good enough to do that, but when they started becoming running out of money, okay, when they all fell apart and all the rest of that, they sold this technology that they had, that they had actually developed with us, hand in hand, behind, under the table, all right, they sold a tremendous amount of this to the Red Chinese. So Red China now, with all of their money, see, they're able to purchase all of these weapons and things that previously they didn't have. They could, because now they have more money than they know what to do with, because we buy everything through Kmart and Walmart. But anyhow, so now what we end up with, we have the Russians with the potential to do it. We have the Americans' covert operations doing it. And we have the potential of the Red Chinese. The Red Chinese Weather Control Modification Organization has 37,000 employees. Read my lips, 37,000. Now, of course, this is spread out all over. They do a little bit of everything. But that's how big the Chinese weather modification operation is.
Amazing. Stay there. I can't believe this has gone by so fast. We're going to have you back up again. And we'll be right back. I've got some key intel. We are back live, ladies and gentlemen, and we've got Mark Fauber coming up on what's happening in the world economy. I was looking into the Iron Mountain Report, and I've got links here where U.S. News and World Report did an investigation and found that when President Johnson read it, he, quote, hit the roof and ordered it suppressed for all time. Then top Harvard professor John Kenneth Galbraith, you've heard of him, said that he actually is a consultant worked on the book, and it's just like Tragedy and Hope. That was written so CIA people, section chiefs, can understand. Well, wait, we back communist and fascist and socialist as long as it's command and control. even their own people need something so they can understand what they're doing, even though they're evil. And so, yes, Iron Mountain is real. Plus, look at it. It's all coming true. Just incredible. But you know, speaking of all this, they would say there's no such thing as weather modification. You're insane. Now they've shifted gears and, oh, yeah, Dubai's putting up giant antenna arrays controlling the weather, making their desert green. Oh, yeah, this is happening. And then we see key areas ravaged. And even meteorologists, weather people are saying this doesn't look normal. And they're like, shut up. Everything's fine. I think it's undoubted they're using this to attack the United States so they can then fearmonger and say, pay Al Gore, pay the Rothschilds money, or it's all over.
Well, problem now, like you said, Dubai is into it. See, Dubai has all the money in the world too, so they're actually subcontracting weather control operations by hiring the Russians or the Chinese to go in and do it, or even the United States covertly under the table. If you if you got enough money, you can get anybody to do anything. But as we stand right now, and by the way, one of the lead letters, a cover letter, so to speak, with the United Nations treaty, stated that now that we have the ability to control and manipulate the weather, create tornadoes, hurricanes, and earthquakes. That is specified that now we have the ability to make earthquakes and control the weather. We have to agree that we won't use it as a weapon of war. That was part of the United Nations treaty itself. And what we have now is the possibility of our own people creating all of these outrageous unknown tornadoes that come from no place in 5 minutes and disappear in 10 minutes after doing billions of dollars of damage. We have either that or we have the Red Chinese doing it to us because they are having weather like the weather we've had. They've had, and Russia has been having freezing weather and extraordinary storms of different types.
And fires. And
back and forth. And so the question is, are we today in the middle of the forecasted weather wars? Are we today, the people, ourselves, and the Red China and Russia, are we into a three-way, a major war right now using invisible microwave-type weapons and plasma beams to do all of these things? Because they do exist, and there's that old adage is, we've never created a weapon and we've not used, and that's the story of mankind. So the idea that maybe this is not happening or that it's artificial, no. It's here. They have the ability, and if it's terrible because you can't find it. You can't see the beam from the satellite.
Well, that's the thing about technology and these weapons race. They always have to use it as a laboratory test in the real world because they're always racing with other groups to get that edge.
Like the atomic bomb, there's never been a weapon that we've created that we have put on the shelf and not used.
Bob Fletcher, investigations.com. You're one in a billion. Look forward to having you up in the near future for another hour. We'll discuss some other important topics. Thank you so much for the time, Bob.
Thank you.
We'll be right back. I'm Alex Jones of Infowars.com. Well, for the next 40 minutes, Dr. Mark Faber is joining us. Couldn't be a better time to have him on with the stock markets going down. Fed talking about not going into QE3. Dr. Mark Faber is the editor and publisher of the Gloom, Boom, and Doom Report, gloomboomdoom.com. And this is a short segment. We're going to have more time to go over this, and I will give the number out to take a few of your calls. Doctor, good to have you with us. Wow, what's happening right now in the world?
What is happening is happening at this moment, but we have to go back somehow in history to know exactly where we stand. Basically,